Welcome to Power Gen International, the event where power generation issues that confront our energy every day are dealt with. Who will win the war on coal? Will there be more emission standards to contend with? Is the world ready to support nuclear development post-Fukushima? How much renewable energy can we safely and economically use? Which are the best financing options in today's market? Questions that directly affect our jobs, communities, and the very way we live. PowerGen International serves as a beacon to bring these questions to light and to provide answers. With four events, 68 conference sessions, over 300 speakers, more than 1,400 exhibitors, and a staggering 21,000 attendees, PowerGen International provides the power generation industry as a whole a solid platform to share ideas and offer enhanced ways to do business. Witness the latest in technology in an expansive exhibition. Visit leading-edge manufacturers. Execute all stages of the purchasing process straight from the show floor, and even get a shot at rolling away in a new set of wheels. With world-class conference sessions to explore new ideas and gain vital insight from leading experts in the field, and be challenged with thought-provoking plenary and mega sessions. All while developing valuable relationships and essential networking events. Now, as we head into 2013, with a newly re-elected president in office, we must continue to face the hard questions head-on and seek the answers at PowerGen International. Mark your calendars. Returning right here. Four events, four change. November 2013. PowerGen International Experience starts now.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Russell Ray, Managing Editor for Power Engineering Magazine and the PowerGen International Program Committee Chair.
Good morning. We are so very glad to have you here in Orlando, Florida. How is everybody doing? Are you fired up? One more time, and I want to hear it all the way in the back row. Are you fired up? All right. Thank you so very much for being here. That's the kind of energy, that's the kind of passion that has made this week possible. Thank you for being here, and welcome to PowerGen International 2012. This is the greatest conference and exhibition in the world for the greatest industry in the world. PowerGen is not alone this year. We brought a few friends. In addition to PowerGen, you will have the chance to attend Nuclear Power International, the Renewable Energy World Conference and Expo, and the Financial Forum. That's four conferences and three exhibitions in one place. If you can't find it here, you can't find it anywhere. This will be the most comprehensive examination of the issues, the trends, the challenges facing the global power market today. Every sector of this market is changing. Power producers are adapting to the changes the best they can. They're looking for cost-effective solutions. They're looking for the best technology. They're looking for the best information. And they're looking for help to adapt to this rapidly changing market. PowerGen is growing each and every year, and we're expanding to other markets across the world. So we've put together a short video about our latest venture in a place where the power generation market is growing at breakneck speed. I'm proud to introduce to you PowerGen Brazil. Here's the video.
With a population of 195 million, living in an area of 8.5 million square kilometers, Brazil is South America's largest country. Its GDP increased by over 7% in 2010, with anticipated growth of 4.1% in 2012. To sustain this accelerated development, Brazil's energy plan calls for the total generating capacity to rise to 167 gigawatts by the end of 2019, representing approximately 60% in required electricity production growth, of which 12 gigawatts will be wind generated. This is, of course, a huge opportunity for the power generation market, an opportunity worth $550 billion. Introducing PowerGen Brazil, Latin America's newest event covering the key technologies, trends, and challenges for the power generation industry. Co-located with Hydrovision Brazil and Distributec Brazil, PowerGen Brazil provides a strategic platform for information exchange, networking, and new business development for the power generation market. With Brazil facing the need for a massive expansion of its energy sector to keep pace with the demands of economic growth, PowerGen Brazil's technical conference will address key issues and hot topics, plus feature an exhibition showcasing hundreds of products and services from leading equipment manufacturers and suppliers. PowerGen Brazil completes the global network of PowerGen events, collectively attracting nearly 70,000 power professionals around the world. The PowerGen brand is synonymous with superior conferences and exhibitions, showcasing the leaders in the power industry and offering unsurpassed networking opportunities. Join us in Sao Paulo and see what is new, now, and next for the Latin American power generation market. Welcome to PowerGen Brazil.
PowerGen Brazil, that's coming up in September of next year. We hope to see you there. This is a real important week, and for me, the goal is this. By the end of this week, we want you to walk away inspired. Inspired about your job and about the industry you work for. We want you to leave here armed with new information and new ideas that can help you and your company achieve your goals, whether it be in power production and efficiency or product sales. Our mission this week is to advance this industry by bringing it together. We've got a great conference program planned for you this week, including all four conferences. We have more than 70 conference sessions, more than 300 speakers, and more than 1,300 exhibiting companies. This is the biggest power gen we've ever had, and everyone's here to help you achieve your goals by sharing their knowledge and their innovations. The exhibit floor, by the way, will open this morning at 11:30, right after this keynote session. It took a lot of people to make this happen this week. The people I'm talking about are the folks who serve on the conference program committees for PGI, NPI, REW, and the Financial Forum. More than 130 people serve on these committees, and they have been working long and hard on recruiting speakers and refining the content for all four conferences. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize their efforts. Many of the committee members are here with us today, so I'd like to ask the committee members who are here with us today to please stand to be recognized for all of your hard work. Thank you. Now, nearly everyone here has a cell phone. I hope they're turned off right now. But right after today's keynote session, I would encourage you to turn those phones back on so you can download the free mobile app for Power Engineering Magazine. In addition to the news and video, you can use this app to follow all of this week's activities at PowerGen, Nuclear Power International, and the Renewable Energy World Conference and Expo. And for those who follow the hydropower industry, I would recommend the free mobile app for our sister publication, Hydro Review Magazine. All you have to do is search for Power Engineering and Hydro Review, and then download those apps at no cost. It's all free. We will be back here in Orlando next year for PowerGen. Instead of having it in December, next year's event will be held in mid-November. And next year will be extra special, because next year is PowerGen's 25th anniversary. We've been doing this for 25 years, and we're already cooking up some exciting activities for next year's 25th anniversary event. We'll be taking a look at where we've been, how far we've come, and where we're going. The planning for next year is well underway. Before we meet our keynote panel, I'd like to introduce you to retired Vice Admiral and the President of the American Council on Renewable Energy, Dennis McGinn. Admiral McGinn is here today to share a few words about the Penwell Wall of Honor. The Wall of Honor will be on display all this week in the exhibit hall in aisle 500. The wall pays tribute to military personnel past and present throughout the world. The idea for the Penwell Wall of Honor came from our senior vice president at Penwell, Rich Baker. Richard's son is in the Air Force and served two tours of duty in Iraq. This is Rich's way, and this is Penwell's way of giving something back for all the sacrifices of our military personnel and their families. Admiral McGinn is a naval aviator, a test pilot, and a national security strategist. He has served as the director of the Air Warfare Division in the Office of the Chief of Naval Operations. He has served as commander of the U.S. Third Fleet. He served as the deputy chief of naval operations in the Pentagon. He is a man of great experience, great knowledge, and great wisdom. Everyone, please help me welcome Admiral Dennis McGinn.
Okay, we're going to try it one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
What a great honor it is to be here to talk about America's heroes, present and past. Our young men and women in uniform serve our nation and all of us citizens every single day in places close to Orlando and places halfway around the world. In peace, and in war. It's especially poignant this time of year of the holidays that these young men and women, in many cases, are far, far away from home and far, far away from their families. We sometimes get caught up in the busyness of our lives. We worry about things that happen every day in our lives. And once in a while, it's good to remind ourselves what a wonderful, wonderful nation that we have been given by the sacrifice and service of generations of men and women who have served in the uniform of the United States military. There's another aspect to this. These young men and women come from every state and territory, from all walks of life, economic levels, and they are backed by their families. So when we go back to dedicate the Penwell Wall of Honor, we need to remember that any proceeds or donations that go to that Wall of Honor go to the Blue Star Mothers. Blue Star Mothers, an organization that was formed in the midst of World War II, that honored the families that kept the home fires burning throughout that great war, and ever since, Blue Star Mothers and fathers and sisters and brothers have really, really been the backbone of this wonderful cadre of people called our military. The people who are at home also serve. They worry, they're concerned, they are there every single day thinking about their loved one, whether they're not too far away or whether they're halfway around the world. So for just a moment, I would like to have us honor each other. If we could have any active duty military, veterans from any age and experience, and the families of people who are in the military today, please stand up. Please stand up. Anyone who has served as veteran, military, families, so as we proceed over the next 3 days, celebrating this wonderful gathering of professionals from energy fields across the board of every type, we need to remember that our democracy is powered by our wonderful military and the men and women and families of those men and women who serve us every single day. And there's another aspect to this as well that we can honor them in tangible ways, and that is these great people have wonderful skills. When they come make that transition from wearing a uniform to entering our workforce, the power industry, whether it's renewables or nuclear or conventional power generation, distribution, everything from how we make our power to how we transmit it to how we use it, is a great career for these great veterans. So I would ask you to consider in your companies and your day-to-day lives how we can, in fact, create this opportunity for them and benefit their service and benefit the future of our country, resting on this wonderful foundation of reliable and ever cleaner energy. So please join me in taking a look at the Penwell Wall of Honor. Take time after the keynote session here to go and look at those names and to think, especially during this holiday season, about the wonderful men and women. Thank you very much, and God bless.
All right. Thank you, Admiral, for those inspiring words. I'd like to add that shortly after today's keynote session, I'd like to invite everyone here to join the Admiral and I and the keynote panel for a short ceremony in the exhibit hall. There we will unveil the Penwell Wall of Honor. Again, the Wall of Honor is in aisle 500 near the Exhibition for Nuclear Power International. We'll be doing that around 11:45 this morning. We've got a lot of ground to cover. As you know, the global power sector is in the middle of a major transformation at every level, in pricing, in policy, in technology, and in financing. The industry faces tremendous challenges from every junction. New coal is no longer an option in the U.S. Existing coal is in the crosshairs of the EPA. The need for flexible, efficient gas-fired generation is on the rise. For the first time in 30 years, we're building nuclear reactors in the U.S. But cost overruns at existing projects and low gas prices mean the future of nuclear power is still very uncertain. Financing new wind power projects in a world without tax credits for wind may soon be reality. Power producers have some very tough decisions to make. Should I rebuild? Should I repower? Or should I refuel? Our keynote panel will be discussing many of these issues here today. And we have recruited what I think is the best keynote panel in power gen history. Let's go ahead and meet our first keynote speaker. Gordon Gillette is the president of Tampa Electric and Peoples Gas. Tampa Electric owns and operates 4,700 megawatts of generation capacity and provides power to more than 670,000 customers in Central Florida. Peoples Gas serves 340,000 Florida customers using more than 11,000 miles of gas pipeline. Both utilities are subsidiaries of TECO Energy. Mr. Gillette was named president of both utilities in July 2009 and is responsible for all operations, including supply, delivery, fuel management, and regulatory affairs. Before taking the helm of Tampa Electric and Peoples Gas, Mr. Gillette served 5 years as Executive Vice President and Chief Financial Officer of TECO Energy. He has also held several other high-ranking positions at TECO, including President of TECO Guatemala and Vice President of Regulatory Affairs. Mr. Gillette joined Tampa Electric in 1981 as an engineer. 5 years later, he was promoted to Manager of Generation Planning and would later be named Director of Project Services for TECO Power Services. He is a man of great knowledge and experience. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Mr. Gordon Gillette.
this. Can't touch this.
Thank you, Gardy. Appreciate it.
Can't touch this.
Thank you very much, Russell, and good morning, everybody. I'm very happy to spend a few minutes with you here today talking, giving you some perspectives on the topic of this conference, which is the challenge ahead. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the challenges and trends that we see in our business, but first, let me welcome you to this great and growing international Power Gen conference. Welcome to Florida, welcome to Orlando, and welcome to the I-4 corridor as well. Yes, I'm talking about the Interstate 4 corridor that runs from Tampa all the way to Daytona Beach. And this is the area that played a critical role in the recent presidential elections. It also plays a pretty critical role as well. Changing slide here. It also plays a pretty critical role in our service territory as well. As you can see from the map, we serve most all of Florida, especially in our natural gas business. Here in Orlando, we don't serve electricity. Orlando Utilities Commission serves electricity, but we do serve natural gas from our natural gas LDC company, Tico Peoples Gas. And in fact, this convention facility is served by Tico Peoples Gas. To give you an idea of how we think future trends will affect our business, I'd like to spend just a few minutes giving you a little background on our businesses here in Florida. Tampa Electric started in 1899. Our service territory covers 2,000 square miles in central Florida. We have 2,300 team members that serve 677,000 customers here in Florida. And we own and operate 4,700 megawatts of generation from three power plants. And we have about a 10% market share here in Peninsular Florida. We're about 60% coal-fired, 40% natural gas-fired, with our Big Bend station, which is shown on the slide here, a fully scrubbed, pulverized coal plant that has SCRs. Our Bayside power plant, which is a repowered natural gas combined cycle unit or plant, and our Polk plant, where we have our IGCC clean coal project that started operation in 1996. At Peoples Gas, we have 580 team members who provide natural gas to 340,000 natural gas customers here in Florida, where we have about a 70% market share in the investor-owned utility space and about a 50% overall market share, including the municipal utilities. We have a statewide presence, as I showed you on the prior map, and our service territory covers most of the major metropolitan areas in Florida. The topic of the conference and our keynote speeches this morning is the challenge ahead. A few years ago at TECO, we started to prepare a report annually that we called our environmental scan, which we use as a starting point for all our strategic and operational planning. In preparation of this report, we look at our own operations, we look outside our operations at other utility companies in our region and nationally, and we try to determine the trends in our business and in our industry. Now, we're a small to medium-sized utility here in the Southeast in the land of the giants, and our perspective is probably a little bit biased by our size and location. But I hope that some of the things I share with you this morning can be a help as a starting point for the discussion that we're going to have later on this morning and throughout the conference. So exactly what are the challenges and trends and opportunities that we at TECO Energy see? Well, at Tampa Electric and Peoples Gas, we've identified seven challenges and trends. Starting at the top and going clockwise, lower demand growth, lower per customer average usage, higher expectations from customers, environmental pressure, the high growth in natural gas production with hydraulic fracturing, cleaner generation portfolios, and more utility-owned and customer-owned distributed generation. And I'll add one more that's not on our slide and really wasn't part of our study, but that I think is important. And that's the changing trends in fleet and vehicle transportation. So without belaboring any one of these points, I just want to spend a few seconds and share our thinking on each. So let's start at the top focusing on the customer demand first and the challenges we're seeing with lower customer growth and lower customer usage. For many years at Tampa Electric, we enjoyed 2.5% customer growth and 3% energy sales growth. We experienced this strong growth through the 80s and 90s when there were recessions and through 9/11. But in 2008, something fundamentally changed for us. In 2008 and 2009, we actually had 5 quarters of slightly negative growth. This year, we're finally back to about 1.3% customer growth, but we think it's very unlikely that we'll see customer growth at the 2.5% level for many years to come, and 1.5% customer growth may be our new normal growth. The other factor that we see in our service territory is declining use per customer. We're convinced that there's a long-term trend in our service territory that we face as customers are using progressively less and less power in their homes. And we think this trend will continue for many years to come. Now, not everybody in our industry may be seeing this or talking about this yet, but we're convinced that for us, the trend is real. And as a result, unlike the past, energy sales growth will actually be lower than customer growth. We think there are several reasons for this, including customers being more frugal in these recessionary times. Perhaps the mainstream culture is getting greener. But perhaps most importantly is the slow but steady proliferation of higher efficiency appliances, lighting, and buildings. This may be especially pronounced here in Florida, where 40% of electric load is for cooling. Information technology is changing too, with iPads using about 5% the power that traditional desktop PCs do. This chart from the Energy Information Administration supports what we're saying here. It shows that nationwide the growth in electricity consumption has declined since the 1950s until today, and that into the future low growth rates are expected until 2030, with the more recent changes driven by more efficiency and greater and increasing standards. Staying on the customer side and quickly hitting the topic that I mentioned that was not one of the 7 things that we identified in our environmental scan, but important nonetheless, we're seeing a proliferation of compressed natural gas fleet vehicles on our system that return to base at night, with compressed natural gas being a little more than half the price of diesel fuel. We now have 450 fleet trucks operating on our system, mostly in the form of municipal trash trucks that are running around, with one trash truck using the equivalent gas of about a Chili's restaurant. I think a significant question going forward is where the larger personal vehicle market will go. If the personal vehicle market starts to go in the direction of electric, this could be a game changer, and it could actually buck the trend that we've been talking about here of lower average customer use on the residential side. Staying on the customer and demand side of the equation, for 2 more bubbles on our slide here, we have the challenge of defining the changing needs of our customers. We believe that customer expectations have definitely changed and, in fact, have increased in many cases as technology has progressed. Our customers are bombarded with rapidly changing technology such as mobile devices, and as a result, we feel that they have increased expectations in the areas of communications and customer support. For instance, nowadays, customers demand almost real-time information when we have an outage. In 2011, we did a comprehensive study to look at the drivers of customer satisfaction, and what we found was that the main drivers are reliability, price, customer solutions in the form of new products and services, and seeing their local utility as a good corporate citizen. We also found that customers' perception of our performance was maybe as important as actual performance, and that as a result, proactive communications with customers to educate and inform them on how we're doing was very, very important. In other words, it's not just enough to be good. It's equally as important to communicate to customers what you're doing and doing well in serving them. Now, starting to move a little bit away from the customer side of our business and the demand side to the supply and the generation side, where probably we have more experts in this room here today than probably any other place in the world. The first supply side topic that I want to address is very close to the customer, and that's distributed generation. Many residential, commercial, and industrial customers are looking at installing customer-owned distributed generation. We see them doing this both for backup generation and in some cases for continuous operation. In Florida, we saw the trend began after the hurricanes in 2004 and 2005. We view this in the first instance as a competitive threat to the central power station, efficient central power station, transmission distribution business model. But alternatively, perhaps we should view this as an opportunity to partner with our customers. We should view both utility-owned and customer generation, perhaps, as a new energy supply. Further, being a natural gas utility, as well as an electric utility, there are obvious advantages in the gas business to the use of distributed generation. The last three of the seven challenges and trends that I have to cover from our environmental stand are really at the heart of what this conference is about, and that's the specific challenges and trends on the supply side of the business. And it's fitting now that we move to really the top of the supply chain, and that's competing fuels. I know that it'll be no surprise to you when I tell you that exponential growth of the supply of shale gas in our country made our top seven TECO Energy trends. By 2035, it's projected that 50% of the natural gas produced in our nation will come from shale gas. The trends in hydraulic fracturing for shale gas production, I'm sure, are affecting all of our thinking in terms of the future supply and price of natural gas in the United States. This is clearly one of the biggest, if not the biggest, trend in the last 10 years. And as we all know, there are huge implications on the competitive dynamics for competing fuels and competing generation technologies. Now, having talked about natural gas, we're down to the last two of the seven major challenges and trends that we identified in the TECO Energy environmental scan. No surprise, continued environmental pressure is made the list as well. We're impacted by many current and emerging rules, regulations, and policies, and it's a challenge just to keep up with the changing landscape in all of the areas that you see on this slide. This is just a partial list of the various emerging rules and regulations in every major environmental area. We don't expect you to read all this, and probably those in the back of the room can't read it anyway, but we wanted to demonstrate how much we're all dealing with in this industry with regard to environmental change. So now, let's quickly get to some of the conclusions that we're drawing from our analysis at TECO Energy. We're assuming the following in terms of what may or may not come to pass on the environmental front. We're assuming that there is no greenhouse gas comprehensive energy policy in the near future, and that there will effectively be a piecemeal regulation by the EPA focused mostly on coal plants. We think that the trends in the broad use of hydraulic fracturing for natural gas production will continue, but we do expect that there'll be some increased environmental regulation in this area. Adding our key assumptions on the economic side of the equation, we're assuming that natural gas prices will stay low. Given the challenges of lower wind and solar density in Florida compared with other states, we believe in Florida that renewables will remain challenged to compete economically in Florida for some time to come. Now, I have to very quickly say that we're very proud of our Polk Power Plant, which came into service in 1996 and is an internationally recognized clean coal power plant using state-of-the-art technology to use coal and petroleum coke and gasify those products in an integrated gasification combined cycle process to generate electricity and valuable byproducts. We're also proud of a new Department of Energy funding that we've partnered on to test the capture of CO2 as well. Having said these things, when it came time for us to decide what our next generation edition would be at the Polk plant, we first started to look at coal-fed IGCC back as early as 2007. But now, driven significantly by the changes in the natural gas market, we've decided to go with a natural gas-fired combined cycle plant instead as the next addition to our system to be in service by 2017. Based on all of the foregoing at TECO Energy, we're concluding the following about the probable future for the supply side of the business over the next several years, and I suspect that this is not too far from where many of you in the room are. We expect that natural gas combined cycle will beat IGCC in generation planning studies for some time to come. We expect that the increasing proposed environmental regulations and low natural gas prices will cause no new conventional coal plants to be built. We expect that older coal plants that are unscrubbed will be retired. We believe that the addition of renewables will be very limited, especially in Florida and the Southeast. And of course, that persistent questions on new nuclear, including cost, lead time, and cost recovery, will be important in the long-term decision-making of the utilities that are interested in building nuclear. We know that our licenses have been granted, and there are even two utilities here in Florida that are pursuing nuclear. Of course, no prognostication like the one I just made can be made without a little bit of hedging, and we think there are a few wild cards that could probably take us in a different direction. The wild cards are higher than expected natural gas prices, which could be the result of higher than expected or harsher than expected environmental regulations on hydraulic fracking, or accelerated use of LNG exportation. The other potential wild cards are either accelerated environmental or energy policy development at the federal level. Based on the foregoing, it would appear to us that many in our industry must be thinking the way we are, and that is that the new generation portfolios of the future will be cleaner and greener. This final chart shows that the projected new capacity additions on a nationwide basis are expected to be 5% coal, 60% natural gas, with a heavy complement of renewables. When I started with Tampa Electric 30 years ago, we were 99% coal-fired. Now, as I've said, we're 60% coal-fired, 40% natural gas-fired, and as I've shared, over the next 10 years, we expect our generation mix to move more to natural gas. So that completes our top 7 challenges and trends that we see our company facing. I'm sure that over the next couple of days, you'll be engaged in discussions in these topics, and I hope it's been helpful to see how at least one utility is looking at the world these days. Thank you very much, and enjoy PowerGen.
Thank you, Gordon. Before we meet our next keynote speaker, I'd like to let you know about a new, very important award that we will be handing out each year at PowerGen. As you can tell by looking around the room today, this is an industry that's dominated by men. That said, my wife reminds me every day that women are the ones who rule the world. I hope we got this on tape. While men are prevalent in the industry, some of the most powerful and influential forces in power generation are, in fact, women. So starting next year, we will be recognizing that fact by establishing an award for women in power generation. A committee is now being formed. That committee will select a woman whose contributions have helped shape this great industry. An award will be given each year at PowerGen. The committee will meet next year to start the selection process, so we're very excited about this new tradition here at PowerGen. It's something we think is long overdue. And you'll be hearing much more about this as we prepare for next year's conference. Our next keynote speaker is John Wellinghoff. Mr. Wellinghoff was named chairman of the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission by President Barack Obama in March 2009. Chairman Wellinghoff is an energy law specialist with more than 30 years' experience in the field. He is the primary author of the Nevada Renewable Portfolio Standard Act and he helped develop RPS standards in 6 other states. Chairman Wellinghoff was also Nevada's first consumer advocate. And in that role, he developed the state's first comprehensive utility integrated planning statute. That statute is now the model for integrated planning in the U.S. Chairman Wellinghoff played a chief role in creating FERC's energy innovation sector. He serves on committees for the Institute for Electric Efficiency and the National Association of Regulatory Utility Commissioners. He is also an advisor to the Energy Foundation and the Natural Resources Defense Council on China-U.S. energy policy issues. Everyone, please help me welcome Mr. John Wellinghoff.
Thank you, John. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here. I want to thank Penwell and the PowerGen International 2012 for having me here today. We're going to have a little fun. I'll tell you, I like movies. Do you all like movies? I love movies, actually. One of my favorite movies is Die Hard, with, if you remember, Bruce Willis, who played Detective John McClane. I'll tell you, if you remember that movie, John McClane was an extremely disruptive element to the plan of the protagonists in that movie. And this morning, I'm going to talk about 3 disruptive factors in the energy field that I think, in my opinion, are as disruptive to the energy field as John McClane was to Hans Gruber. So let's go through those 3 challenges, and then we're going to have a little question and answers after all the speakers get done, and I look forward to that as well. And I'll say that Gordon was a great warm-up back, because actually he touched upon 2 of the 3 elements that I'm going to speak about. But we're going to talk about them on a national level, so I'm going to amplify them and reaffirm them nationally. I'm also going to show you some of how FERC is accelerating those disruptive effects in energy. So you may want to ask, what in the world is FERC doing accelerating disruptive elements in energy? Well, the reason we're doing that is because I also believe that these disruptive elements are elements that are bringing energy efficiency and efficiency overall to the system. And bringing in efficiency to the system ultimately is lowering costs for consumers and providing consumers with additional value. So let's begin. Let's start with our first element. And again, this is one that Gordon talked about with respect to Tampa, the slowing of load growth. But it's happening nationwide. And it's happening in a very predictable, in a very scheduled manner. Here, though, is a one of my favorite pictures of a office building outside of Paris called La Hive. This is the office building of Schneider Electric, international electrical firm, manufacturing firm. The average use of commercial buildings in Europe is currently about 400 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. The European Union has a target of 50 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. This building, built several years ago, started out at 65, and now they've tweaked it more, and it actually meets that level of efficiency at 50 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. But that's not all that's happening at the consumer level. I remember CEOs talking to me about, oh my goodness, we're seeing this explosion in energy use by consumers. They're buying plasma TVs, they're putting desktop computers in their homes, on and on and on, this intensity of energy use. Well, have you ever been to a Best Buy lately? They don't have plasma TVs anymore, you can get them, but what they have are LED TVs, which, as Gordon indicated, they use about a fifth as much energy. And people don't have that many desktop computers, or if they do, they're transitioning. They're transitioning to these things, to iPads. A desktop computer uses about $25 worth of energy a year. My iPad uses $2.50 worth of energy a year. So we're seeing a distinct trend in energy efficiency. And this is backed up with data. And here's the data. Here's a recent analysis, very comprehensive analysis, done by Ahmad Farouki of the Brattle Group. And what this shows you is the trend over the last 50 years with respect to energy. Looking at from 1950 to 1969, in that 20-year period, what was the distribution of energy growth? Well, it was near 8% in this country. If you move forward, though, the 70s to the 90s, it slows down to 4 to 5%. Moving forward from the 90s to 2009, again, you see the trend going down 2 to 3% to where we are today with projections going in the future. And you look at the EIA data and data from many utilities, it's in the 1% range. So we're clearly seeing a very distinct reduction in the level of growth of energy in this country. And I think it's going to stabilize out at 1% or perhaps lower, but ultimately it's an extremely low level of growth that the utilities in this country are not used to. They're primarily used to making money on additional sales. If they don't see those additional sales, it's going to be very difficult for them to continue. So let's look at the next trend we've got in this country. Here are some devices, LED bulb and the Nest thermostat, that both contribute to energy efficiency, but they do something else. That second trend is what I call, what's called in the IT industry, the Internet of Things. We in the energy industry also call it the smart grid, although many people have their own definitions for the smart grid. My definition is connectivity and communication, all the way from the generation resource through transmission and distribution, system operator, all the way through the meter, not just at the meter, doesn't stop at those smart meters, to the consumer, all the way down to the consumer's toaster. That's what the smart grid's really about. And so here you have two devices that are potentially IP addressable. Apple is now selling LED light bulbs. And they're selling LED light bulbs, Philips light bulbs, that have within them a chip that allows them to be addressed by the internet. So you can control them with your iPhone, you can dim them, you can change their output, turn them on and off, but they also can be controlled, most importantly, they can be controlled by the system operator, as well as these thermostats. This Nest thermostat also can be controlled remotely. It has IP addressable capabilities. So this is becoming to a point where it is ubiquitous. We will literally have, as we see in this next slide, literally have control at our fingertips with respect to the deployment of the smart grid. But not only will we have control, but we will have the ability, consumers will have the ability to release that control at their choice. This is not Big Brother. We have to be very careful about security and about cybersecurity. We have to be very careful of how this is done, but it can be done. We do it for financial transactions. We certainly can do it for devices like refrigerators. But if we want to, we should be able to release that control to a third-party operator, either an aggregator or to the grid operator themselves, to use these devices as resources for the grid. Resources that can do things like provide energy, provide capacity, provide ancillary services. So, FERC is doing this now. FERC is ultimately enabling this at the wholesale electric level. We are putting rules in place that allow aggregators and individual consumers to participate in those wholesale markets. First, we've done it for energy efficiency. You can now bid energy efficiency into the Mid-Atlantic market called PJM, or the New England market, the New England ISO, Independent System Operator. Energy efficiency can be bid in as capacity. But more importantly, you can also bid in something called demand response, which are these controls on these devices, of turning these devices on and off, ramping them up and down, changing their output in ways that can allow the grid to operate more efficiently. So you can bid in demand response into Mid-Atlantic, MISO, the Midwest ISO, into New York grid, into the New England grid. And ultimately, we'll be able to bid this into grids everywhere once we have organized markets everywhere. We don't have organized markets right now in the Southeast or in most of the West, with the exception of California. Everywhere else, however, which covers about two-thirds of the electric use in this country, we do have organized markets. So let me show you the real data of the effect of using this type of a resource in an organized wholesale market. This next slide shows you a chart in PJM, which is the Mid-Atlantic grid operator that operates the entire grid independently. The owners of that system, transmission owners, give over to PJM independent operation, and they operate it all the way from New Jersey through Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, Virginia, D.C., West Virginia, Ohio, on out to Chicago. This is one day in PJM on May 30th, 2011, where they had locational marginal prices, which are shown on the right side of this graph, going from zero to $1,000. And you can see the prices in the morning hours, early morning hours, 1 a.m. to 7 a.m., were about $150 a megawatt hour. They then changed, as you can see, as the day got hotter, and they had more and more load come on, to where they spiked up to almost $900 a megawatt hour. However, what PJM did to modify this spike and to modify those prices brought in demand response. And they brought in demand response rapidly, to the point where they brought in, as you can see on the left-hand side, as much as almost 1,500 megawatts of demand response. And doing that, those prices plummeted. Those prices went from virtually $900 back down to $150 to $200 a megawatt hour. Very, very powerful resource. Resource that's dispatchable, resource that can be called upon, that can be relied upon, just like a generator. It must, under the rules of the market. It's paid like a generator. It must be under the rules that FERC has put in place. Our order 745 says if you pay a generator an LMP amount for a megawatt hour of energy, and someone comes in and reduces a megawatt hour of energy during that same period of time, you must pay the same LMP, the same location marginal price, to that demand response provider in that market. So we provide for comparability of payment. There are other instances where we actually pay more to these types of resources. Another order that we put in place, 755, is an order that relates to something called regulation service. Regulation service is one of the ancillary services on the grid that keeps the grid in balance. Every time you flip on a light switch or turn on an air conditioner, you got to bring something up to keep the load exactly in balance. If you don't, you go out of frequency, out of that 60 hertz frequency, and you start to have either brownout or blackout, cascading blackouts. You get the 2003 blackout in August. You have to keep the grid in balance. Well, regulation service has traditionally been provided in this country by combustion turbine generators. The grid operator calls those regulation services up by signaling them on an AGC automatic generator control. As loads come up, they bring up the generators. As loads go down, they bring down the generators. And this goes on all day. Goes on hour by hour, actually minute by minute. It has to happen on a minute by minute basis to preserve the integrity of the frequency of the system. Turns out there's other resources that can do it faster and better. Things like batteries, flywheels, water heaters, anything that can be turned on and off and signaled. All those things can provide regulation service. And it turns out that they can catch the curve, that is, how the load's changing, much faster than a combustion turbine, because you don't have a huge amount of inertia to move back and forth of a huge machine like a combustion turbine. So if you signal a battery, you signal a water heater, you signal something else, it can go off, it can go on, you can do this virtually instantaneously. So based upon that, and evidence that we had in a proceeding that was submitted to us, Order 755 was issued that says that the organized wholesale markets that have regulation service, that pay for regulation service, must pay those entities who can provide more value to that service by doing it quicker a higher amount. And they do that now under Order 755. But this is an example in this chart again of how effective demand response ultimately can be, and estimated that there is a tremendous amount of this available out here. And here's an estimate on the next slide that FERC did with respect to how much demand response is available. This is an assessment of demand response up through 2020. And here you can see, with full participation, demand response could be as high as 20%. In other words, we could reduce our peak loads in this country by 20% using demand response, using assets that are on the customer side of the meter that can be put in place to control loads and reduce costs overall. Very, very powerful, and it's happening, and it's coming very quickly. And it's going to be very disruptive for generators that are used to receiving these payments that are no longer going to receive them. It's going to be disruptive for utilities. It's going to be disruptive for many, many entities who are in the energy space. So let's now talk about the final area, the third area of disruptive events that's going to affect the energy sector. Here we have a scene some of you may know. This is Lower Manhattan. Lower Manhattan after Sandy, during the blackout they had there. These events were seen with more frequency, disruptive natural events that are causing blackouts, brownouts, inability to stabilize and maintain reliable power, are events that consumers are going to do something about. Consumers already have a very high affinity for control, and this is only going to increase that. It's going to do things like, for example, have people accelerate the installation of solar systems. Here we have Rockaway Beach Club, where they were putting on PVs after Sandy struck, putting on solar photovoltaic systems at Rockaway Beach. So you're going to see a great acceleration in the solar area. In addition, you're going to see acceleration in other distributed resources. Here you have Co-op City in the Bronx. They managed to keep their lights on while buildings all around them went dark. And that was thanks to a 5-megawatt natural gas-fired generator that was a cogen system that provides them for self-sufficiency at this particular facility. So, who's looking at doing these things? Well, you're not seeing the traditional utility generation sector looking at investing in this, but you're seeing men like this gentleman do so. This man, some of you may know, is Vinod Khosla. He's one of those venture capital folks up on Sand Hill Road in Palo Alto who puts his money into extremely risky ventures, multiple ones, many in the energy sector. And I had an opportunity to sit down with Vinod recently in the last 2 weeks and talk about his view of the future of energy. His view is there are disruptive changes coming, and those disruptive changes, he believes, are going to be best effectuated by investing in things that are what he calls drop-in technologies, things that bypass the utility entirely, that really have no use or effect on the transmission or distribution system, but actually are down at the customer level. So that's why he's investing in companies like natural gas-fired internal combustion engines that I saw an example of by two newly minted Stanford PhDs that Vinod is investing in, as well as Bill Gates, that completely blew me away, that they'll have basically commercialized within the next 2 to 3 years that will drive down the cost of distributed natural gas generation for the Walmarts of the world and all the big box stores and everybody else, commercial shopping centers and other entities of that size that will be way below the cost of conventional central station utility generation. It's coming very fast. To see how fast it's coming, let's look at this last slide that shows you the trends in just one sector, and this is the PV sector. You can see the price coming down rapidly through 2012, and the market penetration going up very, very rapidly. Right now, we have over 4,000 megawatts of PV installed in the United States. And I know a lot of people say a number of things about PV. Number one is, well, you know, you can't use it everywhere because, you know, how about the Northeast and the Northern Tier? Well, we have to recognize that the largest amount of PV installed in the world right now per country is in Germany. And you have to remember, Germany's at the latitude of Maine. So ultimately, you know, there are countries who believe that, you know, despite latitude differences and issues of levels of solar insolation, it still is possible to have this type of distributed generation put in place almost anywhere. The second thing people say, well, the sun doesn't shine all the time. You know, you need storage or whatever. There's no storage. Well, that's the other place where Vinod Khosla and his people and Bill Gates and his people are investing in storage. And I've seen a number of storage startup companies. There's one in Boston that I know very well, Ambry. You may want to check it out. They have a very disruptive storage technology. MIT professor there, and he was told that if he's going to go out and invent effective storage, it was going to have to be cheaper than dirt. He said, well, we'll do that, because he's now building storage out of dirt, basically, out of very base metals. It's ultimately going to provide for storage for these types of technologies to be very cost effective. So those are the three disruptive trends that I'm seeing, disruptive trends that I think we as an industry have to meet the challenge, have to figure out how we can meet it in the best cost-effective way for consumers, and hopefully embrace these trends, not fight them. I think we have to embrace them, because if we don't, they're going to run over us. Thank you all. Appreciate it.
John, good job. Thank you. Thank you, John, for those remarks. Our next keynote speaker is Jim Ferland. Jim Ferland has more than 23 years' experience in the power sector. In April of this year, he joined the Babcock & Wilcox Company as its new president and CEO. Babcock & Wilcox is one of the premier EPC firms in this industry. Before joining the company, Mr. Ferland served as president of the Americas division at Westinghouse Electric. At Westinghouse, he oversaw $2.5 billion of nuclear energy business in North America and South America. Before joining Westinghouse, Mr. Ferland served as Senior Vice President of Utility Operations for PNM Resources. At PNM, he oversaw regulated transmission and distribution operations. He also served as Vice President of Global Nuclear Field Services for Westinghouse and led the company's global nuclear service business. And before that, he was the president and CEO of Louisiana Energy Services. Most recently, Babcock & Wilcox was selected by the Department of Energy to lead this nation's efforts to design, license, and commercialize small modular reactors in the U.S., and I'm sure we'll be talking much more about that initiative later on in the program. Everyone, please give a big hand for Jim Ferland.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to come and speak to you all this morning. I'm following a great set of speakers, and I'm going to shift the discussion just a little bit. I'm going to talk about power generation options. I'm going to talk about options here in the U.S., and then I'm going to take a little bit of a look internationally. And I'm going to do it from the perspective of a utility, but also the perspective of suppliers. Utilities need to make long-term investment decisions, and they think a lot about trends and what's going to happen. Suppliers need to do the same. So what's my angle on all of this? I'm a supplier, so clearly I must have an angle. B&W is a company that works primarily in the commercial nuclear fields and the coal industry. We do a little bit with renewables, not so much on the natural gas side, although that won't keep me from talking about it a little bit. I also have a utility background, and I've had the opportunity to run T&D systems, gas and coal, and I have a little bit of a feel, at least, for the challenges that renewables pose to the grid and how gas plays very well to offset that. So let's take a look at, I said I'm going to talk about international, but I'm going to start with the U.S. slide anyway. Let's take a look at the generation mix in 2010 versus 2035. I'm not going to walk you through all the elements of this, but there are two things on this slide that just jump out to me. Off the bat, renewables going from 11% to 24%. That's a pretty big change. When you think about it in terms of low load growth, which we've already talked about this morning, that's a pretty big step, 11 to 24. Second one that jumps off the slide to me is we've talked a lot about gas. You can't pick up the Wall Street Journal or any newspaper without seeing something about natural gas fracking. Yet look at the numbers on the slide. 23% of the generation in the U.S. in 2010 came from natural gas, and only 26% is projected in 2035. That's interesting to me in that I thought that differential would be bigger. A couple things that drive that. One is low load growth, for sure. Number two is the jump in renewables. And number three is a little bit of the realities of the system. We have coal units that run at base load, and we have nuclear units that run at base load today. And gas typically, or at least in years past, has dispatched after those two. In the last couple of years, that changed a little bit. Depending on the price of gas, gas actually dispatched in front of coal, and we're seeing that shift back as we go forward. But that, to me, is interesting. That said, there's still going to be a lot of natural gas built in the U.S., and you'll see in a minute even more overseas, but not as big a jump as I would have expected. So let's take a look at the world. This slide is cheating a little bit. When you look at the world as compared to the U.S., it does not look that different. The reality is, if we broke that slide out, and I showed you a slide that had Europe, and I showed you a slide that had Asia, it would look dramatically different. In Europe, we see an increase in renewables, as you'd expect. Nuclear is relatively flat, and coal is decreasing. Asia is a completely different story. We talk about low load growth in the U.S. In essence, we're seeing the same situation in Europe. You don't see low load growth in Asia, whether it be China, India, or any of the other emerging countries. Growth is tremendous in Asia. I'll show you some slides in a second where you can see that. So I'm going to talk about the four big generation choices that are out there today: natural gas, coal, nuclear, and renewables. Because of my background, I'm going to focus a little bit more on nuclear and coal. I'm going to leave it to Paul in the next presentation to talk a little bit more about gas and renewables. In the end, one theme you'll hear from me is diversity is good. We don't want to put all of our eggs in one basket, whether we be a utility, whether it be a country, or whether it be a company that supplies the industry. It's best if we spread out our risk, just like we're told to do in our 401k. And that's a theme that you'll see again and again. So I said I wasn't going to talk too much about natural gas, and I wasn't going to talk too much about renewables yet. I'm going to start off the discussion with natural gas because it impacts everything else. So this is a price curve, natural gas. Here's what I can tell you about this curve. The left-hand side, which is actuals, is correct. The right-hand side, we have no idea. So we can tell you for sure that the right-hand side of the graph is wrong. But no matter which expert you talk to, the trends on that slide remain consistent for the next 20 years. Natural gas price in the U.S., in all likelihood, is going to be significantly lower than it is in Europe and a lot lower than it is in Asia. That difference matters, certainly from a supplier perspective, when we're trying to decide what our utility customers are going to be buying. A slide like this makes a big difference in the types of investments we're going to make going forward. This is natural gas installed generating capacity. Again, a guess as to what's going to happen between 2010 and 2035. You can see significant expansion in gas, primarily combined cycle, a little bit on the peaking side. You can see a jump in the U.S., 425 to 540. Probably not as big as I would have expected before I took a look at this slide, assuming it's right. A little bit bigger jump in Europe, where it nearly doubles. And again, natural gas plays a role in Asia. Significant expansion relative to natural gas's share today, but it's not all that big in the next 20 years. Talk about renewables just for a second. The interesting takeaway for me on this slide is if you look at the pie chart on the right-hand side, an awful lot of hydro, and you see solar and wind. And we're going to see more and more renewables, whether it be in the U.S. or Europe or eventually emerging in Asia. And that's a good thing for all of us. As the price comes down, we're going to see the renewables coming online faster. In the short run, the majority of the renewable build is really driven by policy. We talked about RPS standards. The reality is at least 29 states today have RPS standards. And so policy is going a long way toward pushing renewables. Eventually, my belief is economics will help to drive the increase in renewables as well. One interesting takeaway, if you look at the left-hand side of the pie chart, solar and wind, as you all well know, those are variable. Those resources fluctuate up and down. Of the three other power sources, coal, nuclear, and gas, the only one today that works well with that variability is gas. Another advantage gas has over the other two competitors today. All right, so let's talk about nuclear. So one big takeaway off this slide, and this shows growth in nuclear by country between 2010 and 2035. A little jump on the bottom in the US, 106 to 119. The reality is today, with four new nuclear plants under construction in the US for the first time in three decades, and a couple of older units being finished, the majority of that build-out is already taken place. Not that significant in the US. Europe goes the other way, drops a little bit. So if you want to be in the nuclear business, you better be in China or you better be in India. That's where the growth is. Significant upside opportunity in both of those markets, as well as the rest of Asia and the rest of the world. A lot of reasons for that. I'll get to one on market dynamics and market structure at the end, but part of that is driven simply by that chart we looked at before on gas prices. Nuclear's in the hunt from an economic standpoint in Asia. It's really not in the hunt in the short run in the U.S. when gas price is $3, $4, or $5. In the U.S., it's more of a strategic diversification decision than it is a purely economic decision. Talk about coal for a second. You can see in the U.S., and even more so in Europe, the amount of coal being used for electric generation is dropping. Coal still has a significant role going forward, and I'll talk about in just a second about the implications for the suppliers that play in that part of the spectrum. But in the U.S. and in Europe, not surprisingly, and I agree with these general trends, we're going to see a reduced reliance on coal. That said, it's still a big part of the backbone of our generating resource. You see exactly the opposite in China and in India. So just like my comment on nuclear, if you want to be a supplier and you want to build new coal units, you better be in China and you better be in India. You better have a presence in Asia because that's where it's going to get built. Let me talk just a minute again from the supplier side. We talk about new coal plants. I know at my company, we have zero new coal plants in the strategic plan in the U.S. We have an awful lot of new coal build overseas in Asia. That said, it still remains a very, very good market from a supplier perspective. You have no new coal units coming on in the U.S. That means of that 257 gigawatts that's running in the States, it's pretty much made up of aging units. So there's an awful lot of aftermarket services that'll go into those plants to keep them running and keep them operating at top capacity factors. And the general trend of environmental regulation, whichever specific rule you look at, it's a little hard to follow because they go like this, but the general trend of regulation is clearly increasing. And there's also opportunities on the supplier side for environmental upgrades that are going to go into all those units to keep them up running, to keep them running, and to keep them modern. So just a minute from a customer perspective. It's a tough decision if you're a customer. Where are you going to invest? It's made a little bit easier because we don't see huge load growth, at least in the States. But there are a lot of things for our utility customers to consider. Cost, levelized cost of energy, environmental impacts, fuel availability, new regulations. And then there are some structural differences when you take a look at these options. If we're talking about coal and nuclear, and to some extent renewables, very, very high capital cost, relatively low operating cost in terms of fuel and O&M. Natural gas is quite a bit different. A much smaller capital cost, but a much higher fuel and O&M. Very different decisions to be made. So, from a utility perspective, and when suppliers look at utilities, and we try to determine how are utilities going to make buy decisions today, and what are they going to be buying 15 years from now? Because I need to be making investments today, so I'm in position to be a preferred supplier 10 years from now. Size matters. Size of the utility matters. On the left-hand side, the average, actually relatively large U.S. utility, about $25 billion market cap. In Europe, almost twice as large, much larger utilities. And in Asia, three or four times as big. So why does that matter? Let's take a look at, I mentioned before, high capital cost for coal and nuclear, a little bit lower capital cost for gas. If you're going to be in the nuclear business, and you're going to build these new 1,000 megawatt passive plants, great technology, very reliable, ultra safe, but a big investment. You're talking $10, $12, $15 billion investment. You have a very limited number of customers in the United States that can afford to make that decision, even if they want to. A little bit easier in Europe. Not that nuclear is overly popular in most of Europe today. Quite a bit easier in Asia for the Asian utilities to make a big investment in nuclear. It's more affordable. So as a supplier, if we look at that and we say, wow, kind of a limited market. If I want to play in the nuclear market going forward, what can I do to change that equation? Is there a game-changing technology out there? One option, small modular reactors. They're not here today. They won't be here for another 5 to 10 years. But the concept makes sense. Smaller megawatt output means a much smaller capital investment up front. It means they fit into the grid a little bit better. Some portions of the grid can take 1,100 megawatts or maybe a dual unit 2,200 megawatts all at once. A lot of the grid doesn't like that. If the concept is some of these older coal units are going to come offline, and you sure would like to take advantage of that site, combined cycle works, combined cycle gas, these small modular reactors can fit into the grid relatively well. And then the last feature, which is really a differentiator, and it's pretty easy for me to talk about this because none of these small modular reactors are actually running, but I'm quite sure they're all going to be able to load follow. Right? That's one of the disadvantages of nuclear and coal today. As the renewables cycle up and down, you have to rely on a gas plant to move opposite. Very, very difficult to move large nuclear and large coal units up and down quickly. Small modular reactors should be different. All of the designs that are out there today are designed to load follow at about 10% per minute. So maybe not quite as quick as gas, but should serve the same purpose. It would be a big advantage. Again, that said, great concept. It'll be a few years away before small modular reactors start to influence those pie charts we saw at the beginning of the presentation. So let me wrap up my portion of the discussion. We've heard the phrase many times, we just got done with the election, we're in Florida. All of the above energy strategy. To me, it makes some sense. Diversity is key. I've shown you some nice pie charts this morning that would say we know exactly what the world's going to look like in 2035. We don't. They seem to be a reasonable guess to me, but we don't know. And these are four really good choices. In my view, diversity is key today, and it's going to be key for us all as we go forward. So let me just wrap it up with this. It's an important conference. Energy is a big deal. It impacts quality of life and standard of living in the US, in Europe, and in all the emerging economies around the world. It really is a big deal. Times are changing rapidly. Technology is leading the way. In the end, whether we're a utility that's making these investment decisions and generating the power, whether we're a supplier, it all comes down to people. If we have the right people, they have the right leadership, we give them the tools they need to drive us forward as an industry, we'll all be successful. So with that, thank you all very much. I appreciate the time.
Thank you, Jim. Good information. We'll be hearing more from Jim during our Q&A. Our next keynote speaker is Paul Browning. Paul Browning is president and CEO of Thermal Products for GE Power and Water. He oversees the worldwide operations of GE's heavy-duty gas turbine, steam turbine, generator, controls, gasification, and concentrated solar power businesses. Before joining GE, Mr. Browning served as managing director of Caterpillar Motoren in Germany, where he oversaw a global business in Caterpillar's marine and petroleum power division. He also served as vice president of turbo machinery products in Caterpillar's solar turbines division. Mr. Browning began his career at GE. He started his professional career as a research engineer at the GE Research Center in New York. He has a lot of exciting things to talk about today. Everyone, please help me welcome Paul Browning.
Thank you, Russell, and good morning to my fellow presenters, our valued customers in the audience, EPC partners, IPPs, developers. Welcome to beautiful Orlando. My name is Paul Browning, and I'm the president and CEO of the Thermal Products Division of GE Power and Water. The topic for today is the challenge ahead. Since Jim already covered coal and nuclear energy, I'm going to focus my comments on oil, natural gas, and renewables. Although I will allow myself one indulgence on coal, as you'll see as we go along. But speaking about the challenge ahead really comes naturally at GE. More than 100 years ago, our founder, Thomas Edison, made a simple statement that we've followed ever since. I find out what the world needs, then I proceed to invent. This spirit is alive and well at GE today, where our entire business model is built around developing technology that's needed to solve the world's greatest challenges. Usually, when we talk about energy challenges, we hear a lot of doom and gloom. I'm often accused of being a bit of an optimist, and I have to tell you that I think, standing here today, there's quite a lot to be optimistic about. And if you're going to be optimistic, there's really no better place to start than natural gas. The long-term prospects for natural gas have never looked more favorable. While conventional gas plays continue to be built out around the world, and global gas markets become more linked by expanding LNG transport, unconventional gas is now widely recognized as a game changer. The unconventional gas revolution is well underway here in North America and has now made the United States the leading producer of natural gas in the world. $3 gas in North America is fundamentally altering the split between coal and gas-fired power generation. With most of the U.S. gas-fired fleet being GE machines, we know firsthand that capacity factors have increased from 45% to over 80% in recent years. But unconventional gas is not a phenomenon that's going to be limited to the United States. As just one example, I show here data for China, where a combination of conventional and unconventional gas development promises to make China one of the world's largest gas-fired power generation markets. This is a projection, but I can tell you firsthand it's happening today. A market that was a 2-gigawatt market a few years ago, this year will be 10 gigawatts, and we expect it to go even higher in the future. So gas is growing globally. Unconventional gas, which the rest of the world will be seeing more and more of, is going to be a real game changer. And so at GE, we're betting that natural gas is on a global super cycle that will last 25 years or more. Now, another challenge that's received a lot of attention during the past decade is the scalability and affordability of renewable power. Here again, I see a lot of reason for optimism. Global installs are up by a factor of 8 since 2003, and renewables now make a very material contribution to electrical grids in many parts of Europe, the US, and elsewhere. And look at what's happened in recent years to the cost of renewables. We show here our own internal data for the levelized cost of onshore wind. Remember, we're a leading provider of wind turbines globally, so we have a fair idea how these things are priced. In deals that are happening today, wind is selling at a levelized cost of electricity of 5 cents a kilowatt hour without subsidy. That is a new area that we've entered. Now, as a gas turbine guy, I'm going to claim that the power, a megawatt hour produced by a wind turbine isn't worth as much as a megawatt hour produced by a gas turbine, and that's because of its intermittency, which is another challenge I'll talk about more in a moment. But even I have to admit, 5 cents a kilowatt hour is a very impressive number that is increasingly competitive with fossil fuels. And as many in this audience are aware, solar energy is making similarly impressive gains, with photovoltaic these days approaching an installed cost below 10 cents a kilowatt hour. Now on to climate change. In 2005, when the Kyoto Protocol was enacted, the U.S. was the world's largest emitter of greenhouse gases, and the U.S.'s refusal to sign on to Kyoto was widely debated and widely reported. In 2006, the Energy Information Administration predicted that U.S. carbon dioxide emissions would increase by 60% to 8,114 million metric tons by 2030. What's been less well-publicized is that in the years since 2005, the U.S. has reduced its greenhouse gas emissions more than any country in the world. Now, admittedly, some of that reduction has to be attributed to the global financial crisis and the drop in electrical demand that Gordon spoke about earlier. However, a recent study from Harvard University showed that the bigger contributor was the shift from coal toward gas generation that occurred due to this game-changing, unconventional gas availability and cost that I spoke about earlier. In fact, for the first time since the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, which means really for the first time in the history of our country, total CO2 emissions are on the decline in the United States. According to a recent Energy Outlook report from the EIA, energy-related gas emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, will continue to decline through 2025, and even out as far as 2040, will still be 5% below where they were in 2005. Now, I told you before I'm a gas turbine guy, and that most of the U.S. installed fleet of gas turbines are GE products. You know, for years, we've been saying that a switch from coal to natural gas and renewables could provide us with reduced greenhouse gas emissions, and we just saw it happen before our very eyes. It's no longer a prognostication, it's a fact. I couldn't be more proud to have been on the, had a front row seat while this, while the U.S. reversed its increase in greenhouse gas emissions for the first time in the history of our country. Now, let's shift our focus to oil in the Middle East. Events unfolding in Saudi Arabia provided an excellent example of the energy challenges the region's facing. According to a recent report from Chatham House, Saudi Arabia, the world's largest exporter of oil, is threatened by domestic fuel consumption. As their domestic economy grows and water and air conditioning demand increases, they're consuming so much energy at home that their oil export markets are at risk. Their current domestic demand for oil and gas is growing at a rate of 7% a year and consuming one quarter of their total oil production. That equals about 2.8 million barrels per day. If they continue on this trajectory, they will become a net importer of oil by 2038, which would be a problem for Saudi Arabia, but would also be a problem for the world. Now, the leaders of Saudi Arabia have recognized this problem, and they're responding in a number of ways to reduce their use of oil for power generation. First, when they do use petroleum products to produce power, they want to use the bottom of the barrel, rather than valuable refined products. To that end, we're bringing technology to the kingdom that helps them gasify vacuum residuals from their refineries and burn it in efficient combined cycle power plants. We've also developed technology to allow the use of heavy oil in highly efficient combined cycle plants. Now, with the incredible solar intensity in Saudi Arabia, the kingdom is also looking towards solar power, including solar thermal technology that can be integrated with a combined cycle power plant. And finally, we continue to bring our latest natural gas-fired combined cycle technology to Saudi Arabia. Now, although I've been asked to focus on oil and gas and renewables, I can't miss an opportunity to make a little news today. So it's with a lot of pride I announce that our customer, Duke Energy, has just started producing power from gasified coal at the 618-megawatt Duke Edwardsport IGCC power plant. You heard Gordon talk earlier about the Polk plant for Tampa Electric. This plant's about two times the size of that. It's also carbon capture ready, so after Gordon and the DOE master carbon capture at Polk, this plant will be ready. And we're also taking this technology to China, where we're building projects three times the size of Duke in their coal to chemicals industry that are going to lay the foundation for lower cost IGCC going forward. Okay, so, and I should mention here, when we started up Polk 10, 15 years ago, it took months. We started up the first train here at Duke in 12 days. We started up the second train in 2 days. So, you know, IGCC is really becoming a viable technology. Okay, let's go to the next chart. So, from the challenges I've described thus far, we at GE see this list of what we're calling megatrends because both of their likelihood and potential impact on the industry over the long term, and let's say the next decade or so. Now, while the specific timing or pace at which different countries or regions may experience these megatrends is going to vary, I'm confident that these are good long-term bets for our industry. In fact, these are the fundamentals shaping the investments that we're making at GE and the technologies that we're developing. Now, the only megatrend here that I've not yet addressed is new product velocity. In an industry with a history of slow, methodical new product introductions, we're seeing a dramatic acceleration of new technologies and products of all kinds. Manufacturers, EPCs, IPPs, developers, utilities will increasingly have to contend with an industry whose biological clock has gone into overdrive. At GE, we're investing in analytical tools and product validation facilities that allow us to not only keep up, but to thrive and deliver reliable, proven technology in this fast-change environment. During this decade alone, GE is expecting to introduce 10 new heavy-duty gas turbines to our industry. But for me, the most important thing, the most interesting thing to consider is how these different megatrends are going to interact. And I think these interactions are going to result in new and unexpected directions for our industry. And I'd like to focus on just one of those interactions right now. As the affordability and scale of renewables progresses, we're faced with a new challenge called intermittency. Renewable fuel sources are variable in nature. The wind's not always blowing, the sun's not always shining, and even hydro resources are intermittent on a seasonal timescale. Flexible natural gas generation has always served as the balancing mechanism between stable baseload power generation sources like nuclear and coal and variable electrical demand. Large-scale intermittency now greatly compounds that challenge. GE and NREL completed a study on the effects of increasing renewable penetration on the Western Interconnect, which is a grid, you know, in the western United States. The study showed that the need for gas-fired power generation to become highly cyclic in response to the volatility in supply that comes from renewable resources was increasing. And you can see that on the charts on the top of this page. So you can see that combined cycle plants that once ran in near continuous duty will spend less time at full load and start and stop more frequently when they need to balance the intermittency of renewable energy. Now, the scenario described in this study has already played out somewhat in the western United States, where renewable penetration approaches 20% in some places. But if you want to see a view of the future, take a look at the data on the bottom of this page that were collected during a short five-year span in Spain. Spain retired their coal fleet and greatly increased their renewables capacity during the same time, and look at the profound impact it had on the flexible duty cycle of its gas turbine fleet, which also happens to be largely GE technology. What has occurred in Spain and is predicted to occur in some portions of the U.S. and other areas, according to the NREL study, we think will play out in other countries and other regions with high aspirations for renewables. So a few years ago, as part of our Eco-Imagination initiative, we started to have our engineers and scientists focus on the problem of integrating natural gas and renewables to provide affordable, cleaner power. What they discovered is that in the future, natural gas-fired power plants would need to combine great flexibility and great fuel efficiency like never before. Because you see, in the past, you could buy a highly efficient baseload power plant or a highly flexible gas turbine power plant, but you had to choose between one or the other. We decided that the world needed a power plant that combined world-class efficiency with world-class flexibility, and we proceeded to invent. 2 years ago, we branded a new word, flex-efficiency. Flex-efficiency is defined as profitable annual megawatt hours produced divided by your annual fuel consumption. We believe that for the power plant of the future, this is the most relevant economic metric. It represents a power plant's efficiency over a variety of operating conditions, and GE believes owners and operators can generate electricity more cost-effectively if they include flexibility and efficiency considerations in their project economic evaluation models. In fact, as we study how our plant operation data from actual power plants operating around the world, we're surprised at how few hours they actually spend at full load conditions, even for customers whose electrical grids have not been heavily penetrated by renewables. They spend time balancing market demand. They at times reduce to minimum load or shut down as renewable sources or other sources come up and down. And they are often the counterbalance to less flexible technologies like nuclear and coal. So with this new math of flex efficiency, the economic modeling of power plants requires additional attributes such as part load efficiency, turndown, fast start capability, and fast ramping. And of course, you need a power plant that can operate over this entire range of conditions without ever leaving emissions compliance. So we now offer flex efficiency technologies in both 50 and 60 hertz. And one of the great things about a flexible technology is if what you need is the world's best baseload power plant, this power plant can do that. And if what you need is the world's most flexible power plant, this power plant can do that. And if what you need is both, this power plant has that capability as well. Which means if you're investing for a 30-year future with a lot of uncertainty in it, this power plant's going to be there and do what you need for the future. Now, the initial applications have ranged from baseload operation for the Chubu Electric Company in Japan and baseload operation for the Saudi Electric Company in Saudi Arabia to highly flexible operation in coal repowering projects in renewables-penetrated regions of the United States and France, to even true renewables integration in the dynamic merchant market of Turkey. As you can see, and as you will see throughout this week, it's important that we continue to provide effective fuel and power solutions for today and tomorrow. GE is investing heavily to address these industry megatrends and their interactions, and bringing advanced technology solutions to help you, our valued customers and partners, to thrive in the changing energy landscape. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Paul. At this time, I'd like to invite the rest of the keynote panel to join us for our Q&A. So as the keynote panel makes its way up here, I'd like to remind everyone that the exhibit hall will open immediately after this keynote session. Also like to remind everyone that our plenary session will be beginning Thursday at 9 o'clock. We have an outstanding panel lined up for you. We have Joe Nipper. He is with the American Public Power Association. We have Jim Fama with the Edison Electric Institute. And we have David Hunter with the Electric Power Research Institute. It should be a really fantastic plenary session. All right, I'd like to invite the keynote panel to join us for the Q&A. Come on up, guys. Are you hiding? All right, here they come.
I thought you guys were gonna leave me alone up here. Thanks.
All right, before we get started, let's give it a round of applause for our keynote panel for their time and insight. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here. I think a good way to start is to go back in time to November 6th. The re-election of President Obama has really generated a lot of speculation about what the next 4 years are going to look like. What do you think? He high priority is renewable energy. I hear he's not too fond of coal. Gas-fired generation is certainly a high priority. What do you think? And if I could start with you, John, will it be more of the same over the next 4 years?
I have no idea. No, actually, as an independent regulator, we try to stay focused on our mission and our strategic plan, and I can tell you for us anyway, at least for FERC, because I wouldn't want to presume for the president or his administration, I can tell you for FERC that we will continue to try to drive for improving efficiency, drive for making markets operate better, and ultimately ensure that we can drive down costs for consumers. I can see FERC interfacing with the administration. I know that they're considering, for example, a new executive order on cybersecurity that will have a great impact on the entire electric industry, and I'm sure that we'll be interfacing there. And we do interface with DOE to some extent as well. But again, FERC's going to continue our focus with our strategic plan.
Gordon, your thoughts? I know we have a new source performance standard, our new plants that will be finalized early next year. Speculation is that we're going to see an NSPS for existing plants. What do you think the next 4 years are going to look like?
Well, it feels to us like there will be more proposed rulemakings on coal going forward, and EPA will continue, as I mentioned before, kind of a little bit of piecemeal regulation, looking at a lot of different aspects of coal generation here in the United States. On the renewables front, I think the big question is, what, if any, incentives will we see at the federal level on renewables going forward? And for natural gas, I think, you know, the big question, as I mentioned before, is hydraulic fracturing and what, if any, additional environmental regulations will be proposed for that technology.
Yeah. Paul, what are your clients telling you about the next 4 years?
You know, second-term presidents tend to start thinking about legacy. And I, you know, if you look at some of the data that I presented and some of the others did, you know, this president, if he wants to leave a legacy of doing something about climate change in the United States, he actually has a lot of wind at his back. You know, the numbers have been improving in recent years, as I said, since 2005. I think the president, the administration, they have an opportunity to, you know, to help that continue forward. Mm-hmm. So I think within the borders of the United States, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they're thinking about those kind of things. Yeah. One thing I would encourage is that, you know, of course, climate change is a global phenomenon. We do all business all over the world. When you look at, for instance, the data that were shown on the build-out of coal in Asia, we could do a lot of good things here in the United States that will just be completely overwhelmed if we build out coal that in a certain way. Mm-hmm. And so looking at new technologies like IGCC, gas-fired power generation rather than coal in places like China and other places, of course, continuing to build out renewables. Mm-hmm. I think for the United States to be engaging with others around the world and recognizing that we're solving a global problem, not a domestic one, yeah, is important.
Jim, what are your thoughts about the White House and what it may mean over the next 4 years?
My view is general trends remain the same in the industry, regardless of the outcome in November. We're going to see increased pressure and regulation on the coal side of the business in the U.S. We all expect that. We're going to see support for renewables and gas. And the administration's been very supportive on the nuclear front as well. Mm-hmm. I would expect that to continue. If there's a wild card in here, it's, is there any renewed traction in the U.S., as Paul mentioned, on the greenhouse gas side? I think there is some wind in that direction. My view would be that's a pretty steep hill to climb. So let's see how that plays out over the next couple of years.
Mm-hmm. Obviously a huge market for flexible gas-fired generation. The gas prices dictate the direction of this industry. Paul, let me ask you, what is your information telling you? As you look at the trends for gas prices, what do you see?
Yeah. You know, I tend to listen most to my customers because, you know, they've got real money on the line that depends on the price of gas going forward. Mm-hmm. And what I'm hearing more and more from customers, not just in the United States, but really around the world, is people are betting on long-term low gas prices. Mm-hmm. Maybe not $3 a million BTU like we've seen in the recent, you know, perhaps a bit higher than that going forward, but long-term stable low gas prices, definitely in the United States and increasingly around the world.
Mm-hmm. Gordon?
I agree with Paul. I think the number for us in our next year forecast is more like $4, mm-hmm, with general escalation from there. But, and so it's a little bit of what your definition of low is.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, four with mild escalation is pretty low and pretty competitive.
Mm-hmm. John?
I think that's absolutely correct that we're going to have continued stable gas prices, even if we are and do get substantial authority for export of LNG. Mm-hmm. First of all, the capital requirements to put those LNG liquefaction facilities in place is very high. Time lags are very long. You know, all the studies I've seen, even with high levels of export, it still is only going to affect gas prices by 30 to 40 cents.
Mm-hmm. Jim, what are your thoughts on the future of gas?
Agreed in the U.S., although I will say, if you think about it in a coal versus gas perspective as to which units dispatch, a $3, $4, or $5 difference in price, although they all seem low to us when we compare it to the world 5 or 6 years ago, makes a big difference in how those units dispatch. So it'll be interesting to see where gas settles out on that front. Worldwide, I would expect to see some price differential maintained. It's not going to be like the oil markets, where the price is relatively the same no matter where you are in the world. I would expect to see some differential. Obviously, there's got to be a push down in Asia, in Europe over time, for sure. It's hard to believe the spreads are going to stay quite that large over the next 10, 15 years.
Mm-hmm. Right now, utilities here in the U.S. have plans to retire well over 50 gigawatts of coal-fired generation. And obviously, a lot of that capacity is going to be replaced with natural gas. More than 30 gigawatts of gas-fired generation is expected to be built during that same, by 2022. Are any of us worried that we're wanting all gas all the time and that U.S. power producers may be becoming too reliant on a market that, as we all know, can flip on a dime? Gordon, can you take a stab
sure.
at that?
Sure. I mentioned $4 for next year, mm-hmm. and at $4, our coal units on our system at Big Bend and our Polk Power Plant will dispatch first relative to our natural gas. Mm-hmm. And so as we see it, coal is still the mainstay of our generating system. Mm-hmm. We've put $1.2 billion over the last 10 years into our coal units to scrub them and put SCRs on them. And we've got a big investment in our Polk IGCC technology as well. And so we think our existing coal units are here to stay for some time to come. Mm-hmm.
John, what do you think? We have a policy right now that says no new coal. Is this, gas-fired generation is rising. Is this a dangerous policy to have in light of utilities' efforts to meet demand with affordable electricity?
Well, certainly FERC doesn't have that policy. However, we are seeing from a trend standpoint, increasing amounts of natural gas, and as you mentioned, increasing amounts of coal generation being retired, either on an economic basis or because of the issues of costs of environmental upgrades. But for either reason, we are not only watching that trend, but we're trying to be proactive. We've actually engaged in a series of 6 regional workshops that look at the coordination between natural gas delivery and generation, and looked at how those issues may play out regionally and what FERC can do to ensure that there is adequate and full deliverability of natural gas to these new generating units.
I see. Let's turn to some of the more innovative technologies. What do you think about the advancements that are taking place right now in the industry? Which technology do you think will have the greatest impact on power generation? Is it going to be small modular reactors? Is it going to be CCS? Is it flexible gas turbine technology? Is it smart grid innovations? Jim, can I get your thoughts on that?
Fusion.
No,
I'm just kidding.
Cold fusion.
Someday. But probably not in the time frames that we're talking about. Mm-hmm. I think it's a little bit difficult to guess. The general trend of technology leading the way, mm-hmm. I think, will continue. I think small modular reactors could play in 10 or 15 years. Renewables clearly are going to become more and more competitive as the technology advances, and they're going to play more of a role going forward. And then even the cleanup technology on the coal side, mm-hmm. whether it be cleaning up the traditional gases, or whether it be transitioning coal units to cleaner from a CO2 standpoint, I think technology leads the way. The trick will be which company and which supplier can figure out which technology is going to go and get in front, because mm-hmm. there's an awful lot of talent out there, and it's going to be quite the race.
Mm-hmm. Paul, what's going to be the hot technology?
I just gave a whole presentation on flexible gas.
I think I know the answer.
I'll certainly put that on the list. But if you want me to add to the list, when I look out there as things that I'm really keeping an eye on as a potential game changer, it's PV. I mean, if PV solar gets into the 5 cents a kilowatt hour range, and there are lots of people who believe it can, I think that's a game changer for the industry and something that, you know, really changes a lot of math. Yeah. But, you know, really, you know, we talk about flexible gas turbines. To me, the technology behind that that's very consequential is unconventional gas. And again, as we see unconventional gas, you know, we have unconventional gas here in the U.S. not because we're the only ones who have unconventional gas, but because we're the ones who developed and deployed the technology. As that gets deployed around the world, that is going to be very, very important. You know, just getting one last thing, getting back to this issue of, you know, price stability, and are we making too big of a bet on gas? You know, when you think about the huge bet we made on coal, one of the reasons we made that bet was because it was a domestic fuel source. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons we were always cautious about making that bet with gas was because we thought we were going to have to rely on imported LNG and, you know, imported gas. Right. When you look at gas as a domestically available fuel source, as we most people now believe it is in the United States, I think it fundamentally changes the, you know, how much you're willing to bet on gas.
I see. Gordon, you know, sure. What's going to be the next greatest technology that makes the most difference?
Well, you know, I will say, as a utility, we're a user of technology. We're not really creating the technology that these guys are creating and selling. And I will say, as a user of technology, the lowest cost is going to be what wins the day. Yeah. We're very fortunate here in Florida to live in a regulatory climate where our commission looks at what the lowest long-term present value to customers is. And we're going to be looking to add the things that are most cost-effective for our customers going forward.
John, is it smart grid?
Well, I think PV is in there in the mix, as is smart grid, where you can actually use consumer devices to be part of assets of the grid. But I think the real sleeper is distributed gas generation. I think you're going to see distributed gas generation be the low-cost source, in essence, ultimately, with some of the technologies I see bubbling up. I think it can really, it will really potentially explode, just like PV is exploding right now.
Mm-hmm. We got time for one last question, and let's end it on renewables. The makers of solar panels, wind turbine manufacturers are cutting jobs. Orders for new wind turbines have plunged. Solar panel prices are at historic lows. If incentives like the production tax credit for wind aren't renewed, what's going to happen to the level of renewable energy investment in the U.S.? Gordon, you want to take that?
Sure. We actually have a little mini experiment going on in our service area right now. The Public Service Commission suggested to us that we try a small program where we provide a $2,000 per kW, a very significant rebate for installed solar, mm-hmm. Up to a maximum of $1.5 million a year. And what we're finding is at a $2,000 per kW rebate level, we're having that subscribe almost overnight. And so, you know, I think, you know, what we're seeing is it. At the same time, we're not seeing customers voluntarily install solar on in our service territory without the rebate. So the long and short of it is we're somewhere in the range of, you know, solar needing to come down maybe, you know, close to $2,000 per kW for it to be economic.
John, your thoughts?
Wind definitely, I think, would be hurt substantially if the PTC went away. And I think we got to look at some rational phasing of it out. Potentially, because I really don't believe we should subsidize any of this. I think it all should be on an equal basis. Solar, though, it seems needs less of a subsidy, as you were saying, and I think ultimately that solar is going to stand alone pretty soon, I think, without any subsidies and continue to grow at its very rapid escalation rate.
Mm-hmm. Jim?
I think the overall trend toward renewables is going to be there. Around the world, it's sped up considerably by incentives. Mm-hmm. Tough business to be in when the incentives are there and then they're not, I have to say. I think we're headed that direction. There's a role for renewables, whether that's 15% or 25% of production, I'm not sure, but we're going there. It's just a matter of time.
Mm-hmm. Paul, your thoughts?
I agree with pretty much everything we said here. I mean, the only thing I would just add is, you know, a rational phase out of the production tax credit, I think, everybody could live with. It's what's difficult to live with is the kind of environment we have this year and next year where, you know, everybody's hurrying to install right now so that they don't miss out when the PTC expires. Mm-hmm. You know, doing just something that project developers, utilities, companies like mine can just plan around would be sort of nice.
Well, gentlemen, we've run out of time. We can certainly carry on the conversation backstage. Everyone, join me one more time in thanking our keynote panel for their time and insight. Thanks, Jim. Appreciate it.
Thanks, John.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John.